Thank you very much for the honor of being here today. I thank especially Mr. Rafiapur for inviting me. I'm very, very honored and pleased to be here today. I was honored last night to meet and speak to President Ahmadinejad as well. And I've been very impressed with the graciousness, the kindness, and the hospitality of everyone I've met during this, my first visit to Iran.
خیلی متشکرم که به اینجا دعوت شدم. ممنونم از آقای رائفی‌پور برای دعوت کردن من به این مراسم. خیلی مفتخرم که اینجا در بین شما حضور دارم و دیشبم افتخار ملاقات با رئیس جمهور محترم ایران آقای احمدی نژاد رو داشتم. من در ایران تحت تاثیر مهمان نوازی و در واقع مهربانی تمام مردم قرار گرفتم.
I'm especially glad to be in Iran because I have written and spoken quite a bit about Iran and about the great question of war and peace over the past year. Around the world today, one of the great questions is, will there be war with Iran? As you know, for many months now, the Prime Minister of Israel has repeatedly threatened that Israel will attack Iran if it does not cancel its nuclear energy program. That's why I want to come to Iran to better understand people and the situation, government and so forth here in this country, because I think very strongly that it is important that people in Iran understand conditions in America, and above all, Americans better understand the people of Iran and the true situation in your country.
بسیار خوشحالم که امروز در ایران هستم چون من مقالات زیادی در مورد ایران نوشتم، در مورد ایران بسیار صحبت کردم، در مورد جنگ، در مورد صلح و در مورد احتمال جنگ که توی ایران وجود داره. همه اطلاع دارید که اخیراً باز این احتمال مطرح شده که اگر ایران دست از فعالیت‌های هسته‌ایش برنداره احتمال حمله نظامی آمریکا به ایران خیلی زیاده. بنابراین خیلی مهمه که یک همچین نشست‌هایی برگزار بشه و هم مردم ایران در مورد مردم آمریکا بیشتر بدونن و هم مردم آمریکا بتونن اطلاعات بیشتری در مورد مردم ایران داشته باشن به واسطه رسانه‌ها و خبرگزاری‌ها.
I can't emphasize too strongly just how much ignorance and misinformation there is in the United States about the situation in Iran. Not only myself, but other Americans who visit this country and other people are told before we come here that we are in great danger of being in this country. There's a danger we may be taken hostage or something terrible may happen. In my own family, people have warned me against coming here. And that's why it's all the more important, I think, that I'm here today. But this is based upon tremendous amount of ignorance and misinformation that is promoted in the United States today, above all, by this lobby.
من نمی‌دونم واقعاً چطور بگم که مردم چطور در واقع در مورد این صحبت کنم که مردم آمریکا چقدر بی‌خبرن و چقدر دانششون کمه در مورد مردم ایران، در مورد ایران و شرایطش. من وقتی که تصمیم گرفتم برای این فستیوال فیلم به ایران بیام، خیلی ها سعی کردن منو منصرف کنن. خانواده خودم تقریبا مطمئن بودن که قرار یک اتفاق خیلی بدی برای من بیفته، ولی من تصمیممو گرفتم و گفتم که به اینجا میام و الان خوشحالم که اینجا هستم.
Just a few months ago, a public opinion survey in the United States made by CNN, a very prominent organization, showed that 7 out of 10 Americans believe that Iran is not only dangerous, but that Iran already has an arsenal of nuclear weapons.
یک مدت قبل یک برنامه‌ای توسط شبکه CNN تهیه شده بود که اونجا نشون میداد از هر 10 نفر آمریکایی 7 نفر معتقدند که ایران نه تنها خطرناکه بلکه حتما سلاح هسته‌ای در اختیار داره.
The media gives the impression that Iran is run by people who are eager for war so that people can die in battle and then go to a heaven with lots of virgins.
صدا و سیما و مطبوعات آمریکا در واقع این تصویر رو در اذهان عموم ایجاد کردن که مردم ایران مشتاق جنگن، دوست دارن بجنگن، چون بعد از این که جنگ کردن و به شهادت رسیدن به این از این راه میتونن که به بهشت برن.
And President Ahmadinejad is portrayed in the American media very widely, and millions of Americans believe that he is a man who wishes to kill as many Jews as possible and oppress Christians.
آقای احمدی‌نژاد چهره‌ای در آمریکا دارند که تقریباً تمام مردم فکر می‌کنند ایشون اعتقاد دارند تا جای ممکن تمام یهودیان و تمام مسیحی‌ها باید کشته بشن.
Americans have no idea that living in Iran are some 15 to 20,000 Jews and that there is a seat in the Iranian parliament reserved for a Jew and a seat reserved for a Christian. The image in America is exactly the opposite, very much the opposite of this, and I'm very glad that Mr. Rafaipur made mention of this, because basic facts like this are absolutely not known by the vast majority of Americans, and these are examples of some very basic facts that need to be better known and understood in the United States.
مردم آمریکا به هیچ وجه اطلاع ندارن که هزاران یهودی دارن داخل ایران زندگی میکنن و حتی در مجلس ایران جایی برای یهودی ها در نظر گرفته شده. اینها به هیچ وجه به گوش مردم آمریکا رسیده نشده و لازمه که بهشون گفته بشه در مورد این موضوع.
How is it possible that 71% of Americans can believe a fantastic falsehood that Iran already has a nuclear weapons arsenal and is a grave threat to world peace? How is it possible that Americans can be so deceived about conditions in Iran?
چطور ممکنه که 71% مردم آمریکا معتقد باشند به این تصور غلط که حتماً ایران سلاح هسته‌ای در اختیار داره؟ چطور این اتفاق افتاده؟ چطور شده که 71% مردم آمریکا فریب داده شدند؟
The reason for this is the reason we're here for this meeting today. It's the enormous grip of what I call Jewish Zionist power, the Jewish lobby, the Zionist lobby, the pro-Israel lobby in the United States, a power which is not only in American political life, but also is pervasive in American media, Hollywood, and cultural life.
علت این موضوع در واقع دلیل دور هم جمع شدن ما امروز هستش. دلیل اون لابی های صهیونیستی، صهیونیست ها و قدرت مطلقی هستش که دست اونها. صهیونیست ها نه تنها بر زندگی سیاسی مردم اثر دارن، بلکه بر روی مطبوعات و کلن صدا و سیما و
I was here invited to come here to participate in a first international independent filmmakers festival and conference, and I spoke about that. The other day at the conference, there was a kind of argument between one member of the conference who disputed the claim that Hollywood is Zionist controlled.
من اینجا برای اولین جشنواره فیلمسازان مستقل دعوت شدم و چند روز پیش در یکی از کنفرانس‌ها این موضوع مطرح شد و یک بحث داغ به وجود اومد که یکی از فیلمسازها اعتقاد داشت که صهیونیسم در واقع بر هالیوود و بر آمریکا چیره نشده و مسلط نیست.
President Ahmadinejad has also referred to Zionist control of Hollywood, but some people deny that this is the case. And tomorrow we're going to have even a discussion at the festival itself about this issue, which should have been dealt with at the very beginning rather than at the end of this conference.
آقای احمدی نژاد هم به این موضوع اشاره کردند که صهیونیست قدرت اصلی رو دارن صهیونیست‌ها و صدا و سیما و مطبوعات در اختیار اونها هست. فردا در اختتامیه کنفرانس هم ما یک بحثی در این مورد خواهیم داشت.
One of the most prominent Jewish film critics and experts on Hollywood in the United States is a writer named Michael Medved. He wrote an article a few years ago for a Jewish magazine entitled Is Hollywood Too Jewish? And he wrote about this subject in this article.
یکی از منتقدان صهیونیست آقای مایکل ودور در آمریکا چند سال پیش یک مقاله‌ای برای یکی از مجله‌های صهیونیستی نوشت و در اونجا گفت که آیا صهیونیست در خدمت هالیوود یا هالیوود در خدمت صهیونیسم؟
مایکل مدد، who is himself Jewish, wrote, and I'm quoting, "It makes no sense at all to deny the reality of Jewish power and prominence in popular culture. Any list of the most influential production executives at each of the major movie studios will produce a heavy majority of recognizable Jewish names."
آقای مایکل ودور که خودشون هم یهودی هستن عنوان کردن که نمیتونیم منکر قدرت صهیونیسم و نفوذ اون در سینمای هالیوود باشیم. در تمام فیلم‌های هالیوود و در اکثریت اونها اسم‌های یهودی، اسم‌های صهیونیستی و اثراتی از اونها رو می‌بینیم.
One person who has looked into this question very carefully is Jonathan Goldberg, editor of the influential Jewish periodical weekly, community weekly, Forward. And he wrote in a book published in 1996 entitled Jewish Power the following.
آقای جاناتان گولبرگ سردبیر یکی از گروه‌های یهودی اینچنین عنوان کردند که
He wrote in a few key sectors of the media, notably among Hollywood studio executives, Jews are so numerically dominant that calling these businesses Jewish control is little more than a statistical observation.
در خیلی تعداد خیلی معدودی از محصولات مطبوعات آمریکا هست که ما توی اونها شاهد تسلط و نفوذ صهیونیست در تولیداتشون نیستیم.
He also wrote, Hollywood at the end of the 20th century is still an industry with a pronounced ethnic tinge. Virtually all of the senior executives in the major studios are Jews, writers, producers, and, to a large degree, directors are disproportionately Jewish. One recent study showed the figure as high as 59% among the top grossing films.
در سینمای هالیوود تعداد زیادی از نویسنده ها، تهیه کننده ها و به ویژه کارگردان ها یهودی هستند. در یک تحقیقی که اخیراً ارائه شده 59% این افراد که در صنعت هالیوود مشغول هستند یهودی هستند.
He wrote, the combined weight of so many Jews in one of America's most lucrative and important industries gives the Jews of Hollywood a great deal of political power. They are a major source of money for Democratic candidates.
گروه‌های یهودی توسط بسیاری از آمریکایی‌ها بهشون یک در واقع اختیارات سیاسی عظیمی داده شده.
Another American Jewish writer, Joel Stein, who was writing in the Los Angeles Times, one of the most prominent daily newspapers in America, had this to say: As a proud Jew, I want Americans to know about our accomplishment. Yes, we control Hollywood. I don't care if Americans think we're running the news media, Hollywood, Wall Street, the government. I just care that we get to keep running them.
آقای جوئل استاین، یکی از نویسنده‌های یهودی در یکی از روزنامه‌های اصلی آمریکا عنوان کردن که من به عنوان یک یهودی اعلام می‌کنم که بله، ما می‌توانیم هالیوود را کنترل کنیم. برای من مهم نیست که مردم آمریکا چه فکری بکنن، برای من مهم اینه که ما بتونیم هالیوود رو، اقتصاد رو و صنعتمون رو جلو ببریم.
Reflecting their role in the American media, Jews are routinely portrayed as high-minded, altruistic, trustworthy, compassionate, and deserving of sympathy and support.
با در نظر گرفتن نقش مطبوعات آمریکا، یهودی‌ها همیشه به عنوان یک سری انسان‌های روشنفکر، بسیار فعال، با پشتکار فراوان و دلسوز معرفی شدن.
Millions of Americans, in fact probably the great majority of Americans, uncritically accept this image. But one person who was unhappy about this image and who spoke out about it was the famous American actor Marlon Brando.
میلیون ها آمریکایی بدون اینکه هرگز از خودشون بپرسن چرا، این تصویر رو که مطبوعات آمریکا در مورد یهودی ها براشون ارائه کردن قبول کردن. یکی از کسانی که این جرأت رو به خودش داد و در این مورد اظهار نظر کرد آقای مارلون براندو بود.
مارلون براندو said in an interview, I am very angry with some of the Jews. They know perfectly well what their responsibilities are. Hollywood is run by Jews. It's owned by Jews, and they should have a greater sensitivity about the issue of people who are suffering.
آقای مارلون براندو در یک مصاحبه اعلام کردند که ایشون از دست یهودی‌ها بسیار عصبانی هستند، چون یهودی‌ها می‌دونن که مسئولیت‌هاشون چیه. اونها هالیوود رو اداره می‌کنن و صاحب هالیوود هستن.
The views that I hold now are very, very different than the views I had when I was young.
نظراتی که من الان دارم خیلی متفاوتن از نظراتی که وقتی که جوانتر بودن داشتم.
When I was young, I held the views that most Americans did, influenced by the media and influenced by politicians.
وقتی که جوانتر بودم نظر من دقیقا مشابه بیشتر آمریکایی ها بود که توسط مطبوعات اونها و افراد سیاسی اونها بهشون دیکته شده.
One very influential Hollywood film that influenced me and millions of other Americans was a spectacular Hollywood motion picture entitled Exodus.
یک فیلم بسیار تاثیرگذار که روی من و بسیاری از آمریکایی دیگه تاثیر گذاشت فیلم اکسودس بود.
This film that came out I think perhaps in 1960 or so influenced at least an entire generation of Americans very strongly.
این فیلم که فکر می‌کنم در سال 1960 تولید شده بود تقریبا کل نسل ما رو به شدت تحت تاثیر قرار داد.
This film, Exodus, which was directed by the famous director Otto Preminger and based on a very well best-selling book entitled Exodus by Leon Uris, portrays Jews as altruistic, noble, self-sacrificing, courageous, and deserving of support.
این کتاب که این فیلم که بر اساس یک کتاب مشهور که توسط آقای لیان روس نوشته شده بود ساخته شد، مردم یهود رو مردمی بسیار شجاع، مردمی بسیار توسعه طلب و بسیار با پشتکار معرفی میکنه.
This film is about the founding of the state of Israel, the founding of the Zionist regime. It also portrays the British who left Palestine from their control in 1948 as cynical and ignorant.
این کتاب در مورد رژیم صهیونیست و اینکه چطور ایجاد شد و همچنین در مورد بریتانیا و اینکه چطور در واقع فلسطین رو از استعمار رها کرد صحبت میکنه.
And in the film, Arabs, Palestinians, are barely portrayed at all. They're portrayed as faceless, cowardly, and as murderous, malevolent terrorists.
در این کتاب و در این فیلم فلسطینی‌ها به عنوان انسان‌های بسیار بی ایمان، انسان‌های ترسو، قاتل و تروریست نشون داده شدند.
And this film has been a very important in setting the image that Americans have of the Israel-Palestine conflict and has largely persisted to this day, although there's been some very important changes in progress in recent years, which I'll go into.
این فیلم تاثیر بسیار زیادی روی مردم و تصور اونها از فلسطین داشت.
But the what I want to emphasize at this point here is that it's indisputable not only that Hollywood is controlled by people who have a strong sympathy and support for Israel and Zionism, but who use this sympathy and support and use their positions to promote an image of the Israel-Palestine conflict and all other issues relating to Jewish and Zionist concerns to reflect their own agenda.
هالیوود نه تنها توسط یهودی‌ها و صهیونیست‌ها ساپورت میشه، بلکه اونها تمام قدرت خودشون رو به کار میگیرن تا چهره‌ای که مطلوب خودشون هست از اسرائیل، فلسطین و مشکل بین اونها نشون بدن.
And that's why not with regard only to the Israel-Palestine conflict, but with regard to any issue that the Jewish minority or the Jewish community or Zionist community feels is important, the mass media reflects that. And that's also reflected, as I mentioned earlier, in this grotesquely distorted view about Iran.
و این قدرت یهودی ها نه تنها در مورد چهره فلسطین بلکه در مورد تمامی مسائل روز دنیا هست، مسائلی مثل مسائل ایران.
The Israel lobby in the United States, the organized Jewish community, portrays Iran this way because Iran is a steadfast and principled supporter of Palestinian rights and opposing Palestinian oppression, Zionist oppression of Palestinians, and so makes this support not merely with words but with deeds.
لابی اسرائیلی در آمریکا تشکیل شد. لابی اسرائیلی در آمریکا یک کامیونیتی یهودی تشکیل داد بر علیه ایران، نه فقط به خاطر اینکه ایران در سخن از فلسطین در واقع حمایت میکنه، بلکه در عمل هم بهشون کمک میکنه و ساپورتشون میکنه.
And any government, including of course the Islamic Republic of Iran, or any government which is serious and principled in its support for Palestinian rights and opposing Zionist oppression, is going to be considered by Israel and the Zionists an enemy, and will be portrayed, therefore, in Hollywood and the mass media in this way as a dangerous enemy that has to be wiped out.
هر دولتی در این دنیا که دولت جمهوری اسلامی هم یکی از اونها هست، اگر در مورد فلسطین جدی باشه و یک سری برنامه ها و عملیات جدی داشته باشه، از نظر اسرائیل برای اونها یک تهدید محسوب میشه و بنابراین در هالیوود و در تمام رسانه هایی که در دست اونها هست تلاش میکنن یک چهره خطرناک از ایران نشون بدن.
So that's why I take more seriously than many people in Iran the threat of war against this country, because time and time again Israel has attacked others and has defied world public opinion to do what it thinks it has to do despite world public opinion and so forth. I don't know if Israel will attack, but one of the most disturbing aspects of all of this is that the calculation that's openly made by the Israeli leader Benjamin Netanyahu and others is that if Israel attacks Iran, Iran will strike back, and that the United States will inevitably be brought into the conflict against Iran because the grip of the Jewish lobby in America is so powerful that American politicians will inevitably have to support Israel in this war.
به همین دلیل هست که من تهدیدهای اسرائیل در مورد جنگ علیه ایران رو جدی میگیرم، حتی اگر از خان عمومی و مردم کشورشون و مردم کشور ایران و مردم دنیا خلاف این باشن. و بعد از اون چیزی که بیشتر نگرانم میکنه محاسبات اسرائیلی ها هست که اینجور تصور کردم و اینجور عنوان میشه که اگر اسرائیل به ایران حمله بکنه مسلماً ایران در مقابل اون مقاومت خواهد کرد و ایران قدرت کافی خواهد داشت. به همین دلیل آمریکا وارد در واقع جریان خواهد شد و حتی اگر سیاستمدارهای آمریکا مخالف این موضوع باشند.
Many people may find it very difficult to believe or understand that any country, and particularly a country as big and as powerful and rich as the United States of America, could carry out policies against their own interest and actually in favor of the interest of another state. How is that possible?
شاید برای خیلی ها سخت باشه تفکر، فکر کردن به این موضوع، باور کردن این موضوع که کشوری به قدرتمندی آمریکا میتونه سیاست‌هایی علیه کشور خودش داشته باشه، یعنی تحت فشار یک سری تصمیماتی بر علیه سیاست‌های خودش بگیره.
The insistence by the United States that it will support Israel under virtually any circumstances is no secret. About a year ago, the U.S. ambassador to Israel, it was in September of 2011, almost exactly a year ago, a man named Daniel Shapiro spoke to a Jewish audience on this very subject.
اصرار آمریکا بر حمایت از اسرائیلی ها بر هیچ کس پوشیده نیست. یک مدت قبل آقای دانیل شپیرو یک سخنرانی ارائه دادن.
Daniel Shapiro told this Jewish audience, and I'm quoting.
آقای دانیل شپیرو به مخاطبین یهودی خودشون گفتن که
Yes. The U.S. policy in the Middle East, one test of every policy of the administration, that is the Obama administration, it develops in the Middle East is whether it is consistent with the goal of ensuring Israel's future as a secure Jewish democratic state. That is a commitment that runs as a common thread through our entire government.
ایشون این رو گفتن که سیاست آمریکا کاملاً واضح بر این مبناست که اسرائیل باید حمایت بشه تا جایی که کشور مستقل و جدا برای خودش باشه.
The United States makes no similar pledge to any other country in the world. The United States has treaties of one kind or another to defend other countries or to go to war if those countries are attacked. But Israel is the only country that the United States pledges to defend as a specific ethnic religious state. In other words, a state that discriminates against people who are not Jewish.
آمریکا هرگز در مورد هیچ کشور دیگری یک همچین حرکتی از خودش نشون نداده. فقط کشور اسرائیل هست که آمریکا معتقد به علت دینشون، به علت یهودی بودنشون باید یک کشور مستقل برای خودشون داشته باشن.
For example, the United States may support Britain, or it might support Italy, or it might support some other country. But it doesn't say that Britain has to stay a white country or a Christian country. It doesn't say that Turkey has to stay a Muslim country. But the United States has pledged to support Israel in a way that it supports no other nation in the world.
آمریکا ممکن است بریتانیا، ایتالیا یا ترکیه حمایت بکنه، ولی هرگز این ادعا رو نداره، این حرف رو نمیزنه که ایتالیایی ها باید همه یک کشور داشته باشن فقط به این دلیل که مسیحی هستن، یا مردم ترکیه باید صاحب یک کشوری باشن فقط به این دلیل که همه مسلمان هستن. این حرف رو فقط در مورد اسرائیل و ملت یهود میزنه.
One result of this is that the political leaders of both major parties who have any kind of higher level at all are obliged virtually to pledge support for Israel under almost any circumstances if they are to stay in political office.
نتیجه اینه که رهبران سیاسی هر دو پارتی در آمریکا مجبورن که به سیاست‌های آمریکا در مورد اسرائیل تن بدن اگر که میخوان در کنگره و در سیستم سیاسی آمریکا باقی بمونن.
The most important lobby organization for this Jewish power, Jewish Zionist power in the United States is AIPAC, the America-Israel Public Affairs Committee, headquartered in Washington D.C.
مهمترین سازمان لابی قدرت صهیونیست ها در آمریکا آیکاپ هست.
The power of AIPAC is so great that one AIPAC official said once that if AIPAC asks the members of Congress to sign a pledge that the earth is flat, that same evening they can get 70 or 80% of them to sign such a pledge.
قدرت ایپک اینقدر هست که اگر تصمیم بگیره که از اعضای کنگره بخواد که یک سندی رو امضا کنن که زمین گرد نیست و مسطح، 70 تا 80 درصد اونها اون رو امضا خواهند کرد.
An awareness of all of this, of each kind of point that were made here tonight, is far greater than it was just a few years ago. 10 or 15 years ago, if I was being interviewed on radio or television, and I spoke about this power, this enormous power, you would hear sometimes people would dispute it or argue that it's not true, but that's no longer really the case.
این موضوع در سالهای اخیر خیلی بیشتر شده و بسیار تفاوت داشته. 10 سال قبل اگر شما در مطبوعات یا در صدا و سیما در مورد قدرت و قدرت‌های مسلط جهان صحبت می‌کردید، شاید اینقدر مفهومش آشنا نبود و نمی‌تونست که مطرح بشه.
There is a widespread awareness, not only of course here in Iran, but around the world and very growing in the United States, of this enormous power. It's so obvious now because American politicians grovel, that is, they belittle themselves to try to get this support in an effort to be elected in a way that's now so obvious that more and more people acknowledge it.
امروزه در دنیا آگاهی و دانش عظیمی در مردم به دست آوردن در مورد قدرت یهودی ها و صهیونیست ها، تا حدی که حتی کاندیداهای ریاست جمهوری آمریکا برای اینکه بتونن رأی بیارن مجبورن که حمایت صهیونیست ها رو داشته باشن.
A few weeks ago, the Republican candidate for president made a visit to Israel and made many stupid statements about Palestine, about Israel, in an effort to get Jewish support.
چند سال قبل رئیس جمهور کانادا یک سخنرانی ارائه دادن که سخنان خیلی مضحکی در مورد فلسطین و اسرائیل ارائه کردن.
At the time, a very prominent American writer, a Jewish writer named Thomas Friedman, who writes for the New York Times, commented about Mitt Romney and about the behavior of Democratic politicians in this way.
چندین سال قبل یک نویسنده یهودی به نام آقای فریدمن در مورد دستارهای اینچنینی یهودی ها و صهیونیستی ها صحبت کردن.
فریدمن wrote with sadness because he opposes the policies of the Netanyahu government as ultimately harmful even to Israel and Jewish interests. He wrote that the politicians in America of both parties, and this is his words, grovel for Jewish money and votes.
فریدمن گفت که مجبور با ناراحتی این رو بگه که سیاستمدارهای آمریکا در هر دو پارتی در واقع حرص پول و قدرت صهیونیست‌ها رو دارن.
Now this is an enormously dangerous situation in any nation for a very small group that represents no more than 2-3% of the population to have enormous power to push for interests different than those and contrary to those of the vast majority of people in that country and the vast majority of people around the world.
و این برای مردم هر کشوری و کشور آمریکا خیلی سخت بود که قبول کنند مردمی که حتی یک درصد قابل توجهی از کشورشون رو شامل نمیشن، صاحب قدرت و نفوذ بالایی توی کشورشون هستن و نه تنها توی کشورشون بلکه در تمام دنیا.
And this is especially dangerous when that small minority is supporting a foreign power with nuclear weapons, an unstable foreign power that's engaged in many wars. This is especially dangerous because of the risk that the United States is drawn in inevitably into the conflicts of this small other state and makes its enemies the enemies of the United States and the American people.
و این موضوع خیلی خطرناکه چون ما کشوری رو روبروی خودمون داریم که مسلماً سلاح‌های هسته‌ای داره و مسلماً تسلیحات هسته‌ای در اختیار داره و به این ترتیب آمریکا نه تنها دشمنی برای خودش بلکه دشمنی برای تمام مردم جهان رو داره حمایت می‌کنه.
So I asked the question earlier, how is this possible? I want to go back to May of 1948 when the state of Israel, the Zionist state, was established in Palestine. It's very important to understand this because this is where this special lobby power first made itself so strongly felt.
برای درک این مطلب خیلی مهمه که بریم به سال 1948 وقتی که این گروه‌ها شکل گرفتن.
In 1948, the British had announced that they would be leaving Palestine, which since the end of First World War had been under British control, under the so-called Mandate. And the British, in announcing that, also meant that the Zionists declared that as soon as the British left, they would declare a Zionist state in Palestine.
در سال 1948، وقتی که بریتانیا اعلام کرد که فلسطین رو در یک سال آینده ترک خواهد کرد، اسرائیل اعلام کرد که یک سرزمینی به نام خودش داخل فلسطین خواهد داشت.
So, the question for America's leaders was, what should be the policy of the United States about a Zionist state or a Zionist government in Palestine?
بنابراین سوال مردم و سیاستمدارهای آمریکا این بود که الان نظر آمریکا چی خواهد بود؟
At that time, the Secretary of State, the Foreign Minister of the United States, under President Truman, Harry Truman was President of the United States, and his State Department head, Foreign Minister, was George C. Marshall. He urged President Truman not even to recognize a Jewish state in Palestine. That is, not a question of giving aid or money or support, but even recognizing the legality of such a state.
در اون زمان نخست وزیر وقت به رئیس جمهور وقت آقای ترومن گفت که نه تنها اسرائیل رو باید به عنوان یک کشور مستقل در نظر نگرفت، بلکه نباید حتی به حمایت مالی و سیاسی اونها پرداخت.
The US Secretary of Defense, the first Secretary of Defense, James Forrestal also urged President Truman not even to recognize a state of Israel, not even to recognize a Zionist state of Palestine.
حتی وزیر دفاع آمریکا هم به رئیس جمهور وقت گفت که نباید کشور اسرائیل رو به رسمیت بشناسن.
In addition, the policy planning section of the State Department also urged and advised that the president not even recognize a Jewish entity in Palestine.
به علاوه حتی مرکز مشاوره سیاسی آمریکا هم به رئیس جمهور ترومن گفت که نباید اسرائیل به رسمیت شناخته بشه.
The head of the section of the US State Department responsible for Middle East affairs, a man named Lloyd Henderson, a career US diplomat, wrote a long memoranda, long statement to the president about this question.
رئیس مسائل خاورمیانه اون زمان آقای هندرسون یک نامه بلند بالایی نوشتن به این مضمون.
He warned that if the United States recognized a Jewish regime in Palestine, it would mean the United States betraying and stamping on its own proclaimed principles of self-determination and rights of people.
او این چنین اخطار داد که اگر آمریکا رژیم یهودی در فلسطین رو به رسمیت بشناسه، در واقع اصول خودش مبنی بر رعایت حقوق انسان ها رو زیر پا خواهد گذاشت.
That's because the Jews, the Zionist Jews of Palestine at that time, were a small minority of the population. And to recognize an entity that claimed control that represented only a tiny minority of the population was obviously an injustice, and the world would see it.
چون در اون زمان یهودی‌های صهیونیستی یک اقلیت بسیار کمی رو شامل می‌شدند.
In addition, he warned that the United States should not recognize a Zionist state because this Zionist entity did not even declare what its borders are.
او همچنین اخطار داد که اسرائیل نباید به رسمیت شناخته بشه چون حتی اونها مشخص نکردن که مرزهاشون تا کجا هست.
And to this day, Israel will not say what its borders are. It is deliberately ambiguous about that so that it can expand its borders as it wishes.
و حتی تا امروز اسرائیل نگفته که مرزهای کشورش تا کجاست، به این دلیل که میخواد هر زمان کشورش رو وسعت ببخشه.
American politicians like to say that America must defend Israel and secure borders, but to this day Israel will not say what those borders are.
سیاستمدارهای آمریکا گفتن که آمریکا میگن که آمریکا باید از اسرائیل در برابر مرزهای امن اون دفاع بکنه، در حالی که مرزهای اسرائیل تا به امروز شناخته نشدن.
But going back to 1948, in this memorandum, Lloyd Henderson warned even more importantly that if the United States recognized the Zionist regime in Palestine, the U.S. would inevitably be drawn into wars into the future and would create enormous hostility, not only in the Arab countries and in Muslim countries, but around the world by supporting this regime.
اگه برگردیم به سال 1948، اونجا گفتن که اگر آمریکا اسرائیل رو به رسمیت بشناسه، بعدها وارد جنگی خواهد شد که نه تنها بین اسرائیل و یک سری کشورهای اسلامی شاید باشه، بلکه شاید به تمام دنیا هم در واقع کشیده بشه.
So this warning by a high-level official in the State Department proved to be prophetic.
So این اخطار از طرف یک سازمان با یک اعتبار بسیار بالا در آمریکا داده شده بود.
But at that time, in both the Republican and Democratic parties, Zionist Jews had already put enormous pressure, had spent enormous amounts of money to get both political parties to support a Zionist state in Palestine.
ولی با وجود همه این اخطارها در اون زمان یهودی‌های صهیونی قبلاً قدرت و پول خودشون رو به میزان خیلی بالایی در هر دو پارتی کنگره آمریکا به کار گرفته بودند.
So, Zionist Jews were both threatening and bribing even then politicians to get to have them support a Zionist regime.
بنابراین یهودی‌های صهیونی هم سیاستمدارهای اون زمان رو هم تهدید می‌کردن و هم بهشون رشوه می‌دادن تا حمایتشون رو جلب بکنن.
So this was a problem for the president of the United States, Harry Truman. On the one hand, important political backers told him to recognize a Zionist state in Palestine, and on the other hand, his own Secretary of State, his own officials were telling him this would be harmful to America and bad for the world.
بنابراین این یک مشکل بسیار بزرگ بود برای رئیس جمهور وقت آقای ترومن، چون از یک طرف کنگره و سیاستمدارهاش تحت فشار قرار گرفته بودند که اسرائیل رو حمایت کنند و از طرف دیگه تمام ارگان‌های زیر دست به آقای رئیس جمهور اخطار داده بودند که چه عواقبی در انتظارشون خواهد بود.
President Truman's main political advisor about domestic political campaigns, that is to help get him elected, was an attorney named Clark Clifford.
آقای ترومن در نهایت یک تصمیمی گرفتن که کلیفورد نامیده شد.
And so, 2 weeks before the state of Israel was proclaimed, President Truman called a very important meeting in the White House with Clark Clifford, his domestic political advisor, and Secretary of State George C. Marshall.
دو هفته قبل از اون آقای ترومن یک در واقع میتینگی در کاخ سفید ترتیب دادن که
آقای جورج سی مارشال
دعوت شده بودن.
At this meeting, the president had Clark Clifford give reasons why the United States should recognize and should support a Zionist state in Palestine, and he gave two reasons.
در اونجا برای به رسمیت شناخته شدن اسرائیل دو دلیل مطرح شد.
The first reason he said is that the Bible promises the Holy Land to the Jews.
اولین دلیل این بود که کتاب انجیل در واقع سرزمین مقدس بیت المقدس رو به یهودی ها وعده داده.
And the second reason he said was that the Jews had suffered so much in World War II and there were many Jewish refugees.
و دلیل دومی که عنوان کرد این بود که در جنگ جهانی دوم یهودی ها بسیار آسیب دیدن.
George Marshall, the Secretary of State, who was a very formidable, imposing man, and who had been the head of the U.S. military during World War II, listened to this talk with obvious unhappiness.
آقای جورج مارشال که یکی از تاثیرگذارترین نظامی‌های آمریکا هم بودند، به این سخنان و به این دلایلی که عنوان شد و چهره‌ای که ناراحتیشون رو نشون می‌داد، گوش کردند.
And when Clark Clifford was done talking, Marshall said to the president with great anger. We know this because both Marshall and Clifford later wrote about what happened. But George Marshall, with anger, said to the president.
وقتی که این صحبت تمام شد، صحبت آقای کلیفر تمام شد، آقای مارشال با عصبانیت تمام به رئیس جمهور گفتن که
George Marshall said, "Mr. President, this man, Clark Clifford, should not be even at this meeting. This is a meeting about U.S. foreign policy, not about domestic policy. And Mr. President, if you follow the advice of this man and do what he says, I do not see how I can support you in the next election, which is just a few months away."
آقای مارشال گفتن که این آقای کلیفرد اصلا نباید در این جلسه حضور داشته باشد. چون این موضوع مربوط به سیاست‌های خارجی آمریکا هست و نه سیاست‌های داخلی اون. و اگر شما به حرف‌های آقای کلیفر گوش بدید و بر مبنای اون عمل بکنید، حمایت من رو در انتخابات بعدی که فقط چند هفته بعد بود از دست خواهید داد.
But 2 weeks later, President Truman instantly decided to recognize the state of Israel, ignoring, rejecting the advice of all those Americans concerned about American foreign policy and what's good for the United States.
ولی دو هفته بعد رئیس جمهور وقت تصمیم گرفت که اسرائیل رو به رسمیت بشناسه، در حالی که تمام حرفهایی که از توی سیاستمداران و از توی مردمش رو شنیده بود ایگنور کرد، در واقع در نظر نگرفت.
And later President Truman said in his memoirs, or said in an interview later, that never in his life had he received so much pressure, so much pressure to do anything in his entire administration as he did to recognize the state of Israel, and he decided ultimately to do so to put, based on considerations of the interests of himself as in the presidential campaign of 1948 and the interests of his Democratic Party.
بعدها فرومن در خاطرات خودش عنوان کرد که در طول زندگی خودش هرگز اونقدر تحت فشار قرار نگرفته که برای به رسمیت شناختن اسرائیل تحت فشار بوده و هرگز اونقدر فشار از طرف هیچ در واقع ارگانیزیشنی برایشون وارد نشده بود.
And in his own diary, Truman expressed disgust at the way that Jewish Zionists had been putting pressure on them and how shamefully they had been acting, but he did that only privately in his diary. The important thing is he put what was good for himself and his party above what was good for America and the world.
ایشون در خاطرات شخصی خودشون در مورد اینکه چطور در واقع یهودیای صهیونیست اون رو تحت فشار قرار دادن برای گرفتن اون تصمیم توضیح داد.
Now the reason I emphasize this and have told a rather long story about this is because this is what I call the original sin of America's Middle East policy. Because since 1948, every American administration has continued this same basic policy. But this means that since 1948, with regard to the Middle East, American presidents again and again and again, and American politicians, have put their own personal career interests, in the interests of their partisan interests, the interests of their party, above the interests, the true, authentic interests of the American people and of humanity.
دلیل اینکه این داستان بلند رو من تعریف کردم این بود که این رو عنوان کنم که این بزرگترین گناه آمریکا و بزرگترین اشتباه آمریکا در مورد مسائل خاورمیانه بود. از اون زمان از سال 1948 بود که این تصمیم در واقع پایه سیاست‌های اساسی آمریکا شد و امروز هم سیاستمدارهای آمریکا در واقع سود خودشون رو به سود و منفعت و نظر عموم مردم آمریکا ارجحیت میدن.
This has been the case time and time again in the years since 1948 to the present that American politicians, American presidents have supported Israel in ways that they know is not right and not good.
از سال 1948 تا حالا رئیس جمهورهای آمریکا و سیاستمدارهای آمریکا از اسرائیل و از مفاهیمی حمایت کردند که خودشون هم میدونن که درست نیست.
When President Richard Nixon, was president of the United States, his national security advisor was Henry Kissinger. And Henry Kissinger was asked to look into the question of whether Israel had a nuclear arsenal and what should be the United States policy about that.
وقتی که آقای ریچارد نیکسون رئیس جمهور بودن، مشاورشون آقای هنری ازشون در مورد مسائل هسته‌ای سوالی پرسیدن.
Henry Kissinger wrote a long memorandum on this subject that was only made public many years later. We published this on our website along with many other documents along this line. In this memorandum, Henry Kissinger said that Israel has acquired now a nuclear weapons arsenal in violation of pledges that Israeli leaders had given to American presidents that Israel would not do this.
ایشون مشاور آقای ریچارد نیکسون بهشون گفتن که ما اسناد فراوانی داریم که مطمئنیم که اسرائیل تسلیحات هسته‌ای داره که قبلاً قول داده بود که هرگز اونها رو ایجاد نخواهد کرد.
And Henry Kissinger concluded that although Israeli leaders had lied to American presidents and that Israel's nuclear arsenal was not good for America, he concluded in this memorandum to President Nixon that the only way to try to get Israel to give up this arsenal would be to engage in a fight with the organized Jewish community in the United States, and that in such a fight, he would lose politically. He and his party would lose politically, so that the political cost of doing that would be too high, and therefore the United States should tolerate and accept this illegal weapons arsenal built after lies to American leaders.
آقای هنری مشاور رئیس جمهور گفتند که هرچند اسرائیلی ها به اونها دروغ گفتند و هرچند که صاحب سلاح هسته‌ای شدند، ولی اگر اینها بخوان که در برابر ایشون مخالفت بکنند، در برابر اسرائیل مخالفت بکنند، تنها راهی که هست اینه که با جماعت در واقع یهودی ها داخل آمریکا وارد جنگ بشن، یک جنگ داخلی، و این بسیار به ضرر کنگره و به ضرر سیاست مداران خواهد بود.
But Richard Nixon was more aware of even more than that. In early 1972, he had a meeting in the White House Oval Office, his main office in the White House, with a very prominent Christian leader in the United States named Billy Graham, who was at that time by far the most influential, the most prominent American Christian leader.
در سال 1972 آقای نیکسون در کاخ سفید در محل دفتر خودشون یک ملاقاتی با آقای بیلی گیلیارد داشتن که یکی از پرنفوذترین سیاستمدارهای اون زمان بودن.
We know what these two men said in this private meeting because Richard Nixon was secretly tape recording all these meetings in the White House, and years later the tape recordings of their conversation was made public.
ما در مورد مسائلی که اون روز در اون جلسه مطرح شد کاملا با جزئیات آگاه هستیم، چون آقای نیکسون در اون جلسه خصوصی تمام صحبت‌ها رو ضبط کرده بودن و بعدها اینها رو در واقع رو کردن.
Billy Graham said to the president, and they were talking about what they called the Jewish stranglehold on the American media. Remember this word? Stranglehold.
No.
It's the grip. Stranglehold.
Okay.
The Jewish stranglehold on the American media. And Billy Graham said to the president, this is in the White House in 1972, unless this Jewish stranglehold is broken, America is going down the drain.
بیلی گیلیارد به آقای نیکسون گفت که وقتی که در واقع این تسلط اسرائیل بر آمریکا در سیاست آمریکا از بین بره، آمریکا در یک مسیر سقوط قرار خواهد گرفت.
When Billy Graham said that to President Nixon, they were friends. President Nixon said to Billy Graham, "Do you believe that?" And Billy Graham said, "Yes, sir." And Richard Nixon says, "Oh boy, so do I, but I can't ever say that. That is, I can never say that in public."
وقتی که رئیس جمهور از ایشون پرسیدن که آیا مطمئنی، ایشون با اطمینان تمام گفتن که بله مطمئنم، و آقای نیکسون گفتن که با این وجود من هیچ وقت نمیتونم این رو در اعلام بکنم.
Now President Nixon was, like every American president during this period, the single most powerful man, not only in America, but the world.
آقای نیکسون در اون زمان مانند تمام رئیس جمهورهای آمریکا در هر زمانی تنها مرد با نفوذ و قدرتمند در اون زمان بود.
But as great as the power of the President of the United States, he feared a power greater than his own.
با این وجود که ایشون صاحب بالاترین قدرت در آمریکا بودند، ایشون از اسرائیل ترسیدن.
President Nixon feared this Jewish Zionist power, which was even greater than his own.
آقای نیکسون از این قدرت یهودی صهیونیستی ترسیدن.
That's the power that we're talking about today. And it's very important to understand that this power indeed is so great in the United States, then and today, that it's the reason that the United States can carry out policies that seem mystifying, that seem to make no sense, that seem to be contrary not only to justice and reason, but even to the best interests of the United States and the world.
در واقع این قدرتی است که ما الان در مورد صحبت می‌کنیم، در مورد تصمیماتی که آمریکا می‌گیره، در مورد تصمیماتی که در مورد عدالت می‌گیره و برای ما قابل قبول نیستن.
There's a world consensus that has grown up about the Israel-Palestine issue that's reflected in not only in the recent non-aligned movement summit, but in numerous votes in the General Assembly of the United Nations.
در مورد مسائل اسرائیل فلسطین یک موضوعی در واقع یک حرکتی شکل گرفته که نه تنها در اجلاسی که اخیراً در ایران برگزار شد در مورد صحبت شده، بلکه در کل دنیا در مورد صحبت میشه.
Time and time again in the United Nations General Assembly a resolution will come up for a vote condemning Israeli oppression of Palestinians. And time and again, the votes are ludicrous. They are lopsided votes in which the United States and Israel and perhaps the Marshall Islands or one or two other tiny countries are on one side and the entire rest of the world is on the other.
بارها و بارها در مورد اسرائیل و فلسطین گفته شده در آمریکا و در تمام دنیا. ولی جالبه که ظاهراً آمریکا، اسرائیل و چند تا کشور کوچیک دیگه ظاهرا در یک طرف دنیا هستند و بقیه تمام دنیا در طرف دیگه.
What is it that the United States is the only strong bastion of support for Israel? Is the reason that the American people are wiser, more intelligent, more sensitive, more far-seeing than the people of Argentina or Britain or India or Germany or China?
چرا آمریکا صاحب مطلق قدرته؟ به خاطر اینکه مردم آمریکا باهوش‌ترن، آینده‌نگرترن و صاحب اطلاعات بیشتری هستن نسبت به مردم بریتانیا، آلمان، هند، چین.
The reason is the enormous power again. This enormous power of the Jewish Zionist grip on America's political and cultural life in the United States. And the power, this Jewish Zionist power in the United States.
علت این موضوع قدرت عظیم صهیونیسم یهودی است که بر آمریکا مسلطه.
Now this power manifests itself not only in U.S. Middle East policy. This power manifests itself also in promoting policies that break down traditional values. Traditional ethics and tradition and justice in the United States of America and in many other countries around the world.
این قدرت صهیونیسمی در آمریکا علاوه بر اون که بر مسائل خاورمیانه، مسائل مربوط به خاورمیانه در آمریکا تاثیر میذاره، بلکه بر فرهنگ اونها، بر اخلاقیات‌های اونها و بر تعریف اونها از عدالت هم تاثیر میذاره.
One of the most powerful Jewish Zionist organizations in the world is the so-called Anti-Defamation League of B'nai B'rith, headquartered in New York, with offices in many American cities and in some cities outside the United States.
یکی از بزرگترین سازمان‌های یهودی صهیونیستی در آمریکا سازمانی است که در نیویورک قرار دارد.
The Anti-Defamation League spends a great deal of money to promote the idea of what they call individual freedom and diversity in the United States, to promote the concept that society is made up of individuals and that ethnic or religious or cultural considerations are not important, and certainly not traditional values or traditional ethics.
یکی از موضوعاتی که این سازمان برای اون در واقع تلاش و تبلیغ میکنه اینه که امریکایی ها و مردم اون و در واقع ملت اون افرادی هستن که جدا جدا هستن، در واقع هیچ ربطی به دینی که دارن و به فرهنگی که دارن ندارن.
That's why the Anti-Defamation League has spent millions and millions of dollars promoting a campaign under the slogan "Diversity is our strength."
برای همینه که اون سازمان میلیون‌ها خرج می‌کنه برای شناسوندن در واقع باور خودش که تنوع قدرت ما.
Because the Jewish Zionist lobby wants to break the religious and ethnic sense of cohesion and solidarity and identity in all other societies other than their own.
این برای اینه که لابی صهیونیستی یهودی میخواد که تمام مردها رو در واقع تمام اتحادها رو بین مردم یک دین از بین ببره و تقریبا موفق هم میشه به غیر از ایران.
In a speech given by President Bill Clinton, a State of the Union speech, in other words, a very prominent speech, and I think 1982, Bill Clinton took this ADL slogan and used it in his speech, and he talked about how diversity, he said, is our greatest strength.
در سال 1982 آقای بیل کلینتون در یک سخنرانی رسمی این در واقع این حرف احمقانه رو عنوان کردن، در سخنرانی خودشون عنوان کردن که تنوع قدرت ما.
Now the important thing, point I want to make here is that groups like the Anti-Defamation League, Zionist organizations like the Anti-Defamation League promote a policy about society for all countries around the world different than the one they promote for the country they really care about, Israel. In other words, they say that every other country in the world should be as diverse as possible, except one country, the state of Israel.
نکته مهمی که من اینجا میخوام بگم اینه که سازمان‌های صهیونیستی یهودی مثل سازمانی که اینجا بهش اشاره شد میخوان که در واقع بگن تمام کشورها باید تنوع داشته باشن، تنوع دینی داشته باشن و این باور رو میخوان به همه بقبولونن به غیر از کشور خودشون. کشوری که فقط به علت یهودی بودن به کشور شناخته میشه.
The same Jewish Zionist groups that say diversity is a wonderful thing for other countries insist, don't merely suggest, but insist that the United States, as I mentioned earlier, supports Israel as a specifically Jewish ethnic religious state.
همان گروه‌های یهودی، همه گروه‌های یهودی همین حرف رو تکرار می‌کنند که تنوع باید، تنوع دینی باید در همه کشورهای جهان باشه، به غیر از کشور خودشون.
This means that the slogan "Diversity is our strength" and similar campaigns by Jewish organizations are not merely falsehoods; they are conscious falsehoods. That is, they are lies. They are promoting policies that they do not really believe for their own people and their own society.
این یعنی این که یک چنین گروه‌های یهودی و یک چنین سازمان‌هایی نه تنها باوری که دارن به همه القا می‌کنن غلط هست، یعنی این حرفی که گفتن تنوع قدرت ماست نه تنها غلط هست بلکه دروغ میگن، یک دروغ بزرگ رو می‌خوان به همه بقبولونن.
One of the reasons why American people accept all of this more than many other countries around the world is because America is, to a very large extent, a nation of individuals. It was settled above all by people who came as individuals, not to build a specific society, but to better themselves as individuals. And this liberalistic sense of individualism is very strong, very widespread in the United States of America.
یکی از دلایلی که این باور اسرائیلی‌ها در آمریکا بیش از هر کشور دیگه‌ای طرفدار داشته و قبولش کردن اینه که آمریکا کلاً جامعه‌ای است متشکل از ایندیویدوال‌ها، افرادی که زیاد در بند روابط بین هم نیستن. هر کسی باور لیبرال خودشو داره و دوست داره که به عنوان یک فرد تنها در جامعه باشه.
As a result, the American public doesn't have the same national or religious or traditional sense to resist the power of the mass media that will tell them something in the way that many other societies do.
در نتیجه اتفاقی که افتاده اینه که مردم آمریکا اون در واقع انگیزه و اون احساسی که مردم بقیه کشورها دارن در مقابل این دروغ اسرائیل رو ندارن. هرگز اونها نتونستن با هم یکی بشن تا به رسانه ها بفهمونن که اونها دروغ های اونها رو باور نمی کنن.
And that's why the media in America is so extraordinarily effective among the American population in a way that it is not in many other societies which are older, more ancient societies which much more strongly rooted religious, ethnic, and traditional values and traditions.
به همین دلیل هست که مطبوعات آمریکا در میان آمریکایی‌ها جایگاهی داره که در کشورهای دیگه که صاحب فرهنگ غنی هستند، صاحب یک دین مشخص هستند و صاحب یک اتحادی هستند نتونسته که اون جایگاهو داشته باشه.
And that's why, to a great that's why so few Americans have spoken out about many of these terrible policies that are pursued by the United States of America at the behest of, in the name of, or for the interest of this Jewish Zionist lobby, because it doesn't affect them very much in a way that they see as harmful to their individual interests.
به همین دلیله که تعداد خیلی کمی از آمریکایی‌ها در مقابل این نفوذ صهیونیست‌ها و یهودی‌ها در رسانه‌ها و مطبوعاتشون صداشون رو بلند کردن. برای اینکه برای ایندیویدوال‌ها، افرادی که جدا جدا زندگی می‌کنن، در واقع این تاثیر صهیونیست روی مطبوعات اینقدر مهم نبوده.
But things are changing in America very rapidly. There is a large sense of dis-ease, anxiety, of uncertainty, of fear about what's going on in the country and about the future.
ولی در آمریکا داره تغییر میکنه. مردم آمریکا اخیراً انگیزه بالایی روبرو شدن در مورد اینکه داره چی بهشون گفته میشه توی مملکتشون، دارن به کجا میرن و سیاستاشون در چه جهتی هست.
This is much more than concern just about the economic downturn of recent years. It's a sense that nothing is working quite in America the way it should be. That an America that was once secure or seemingly secure is vanishing away.
و این بیداری مردم آمریکا فقط مربوط به بیداری‌هاشون در مورد اقتصاد نیست که در سال‌های اخیر اعتراض‌هاشون رو دیدیم، بلکه یک طیف وسیع‌تری از مسائل رو در واقع شامل میشه.
One consequence of this is a large and growing level of distrust and even cynicism about all the major institutions in the United States as reflected in numerous public opinion polls.
یکی از نتایج اینه که مردم به شدت بی‌اعتماد شدن به تمام چیزهایی که دولت آمریکا بهشون میگه، به تمام گروه‌هایی که دارن فعالیت می‌کنن و به تمام اخباری که از طریق مطبوعات بهشون میرسه.
This is reflected in polls that show that more Americans than ever believe that life for their children will not be as secure and as prosperous as it has been for themselves.
بیشتر آمریکایی‌ها الان به این نتیجه رسیدن که زندگی فرزندان اونها اونقدر که زندگی اونها در نسل‌های قبلی موفق و خوب بوده نخواهد بود.
It's reflected in polls that show historically highest levels of distrust in the presidency, the Congress, and the mass media.
تحقیقات و آمارها نشون دادن که الان بالاترین آمار در مورد بی‌اعتمادی به رئیس جمهور، به کنگره و به مطبوعات آمریکا وجود داره.
It's reflected also in polls that show that more Americans than ever, in fact, more Americans regard themselves as independent rather than regard themselves as either Democratic or Republican. Not only is it larger than the either Democratic or Republican, but it's at an all-time high.
همچنین آمارها نشون دادن که امروزه آمریکایی های زیادی هستن، بیشترین تعداد اونها هستن که ترجیح میدن خودشون رو به عنوان یک فرد جدا معرفی کنن تا اینکه بگن که یک جمهوری خواه دموکراتیک هستن.
One result was that in 4 years ago in 2008 the public disgusted with the performance of George Bush elected Barack Obama as president who campaigned on a promise of hope and change.
4 سال قبل مردم آمریکا از عملکرد در واقع متنفر بودن از عملکرد جورج دبلیو بوش و امید داشتن به یک روند جدید وقتی که اوباما انتخاب شد.
Not only in the United States, but around the world there was tremendous expectation and hope that the Obama administration would really make substantial change in the way America operates in the world.
نه فقط در آمریکا، بلکه در تمام کشورهای جهان مردم منتظر بودند که ببینند چطور اوباما به یک صورت جدید و یک روند جدید و متفاوتی فعالیت‌های آمریکا رو تغییر خواهد داد.
An expression of this tremendous hope and expectation about George Bush is that he was given what may be considered the world's highest honor, the Nobel Peace Prize, not for anything he had actually done, but as an expression of confidence or expectation of what he would do.
آقای جورج دبلیو بوش در واقع جایزه نوبل برده بودند. نه به خاطر کارهایی که کرده بودند، بلکه به خاطر کارهایی که وعده داده بودند.
But 4 years later, that hope and confidence has turned to great disappointment, not only in the United States, but around the world.
بعد 4 سال اون امید به تغییر تبدیل به یأس و ناامیدی شد، نه فقط در آمریکا بلکه در تمام جهان.
You may remember that a few months after Barack Obama was elected president in January 2009, he made a visit to Egypt and made a famous highly publicized address in Cairo at a university.
شاید همگی به یاد داشته باشید که وقتی در سال 2009 آقای اوباما به ریاست جمهوری انتخاب شدند، یک سخنرانی خیلی عمیقی در مصر ارائه دادند.
In this speech, addressed above all to the Arab and Muslim world, he declared that the oppression of the Palestinians is, in his words, intolerable.
ایشون در سخنرانی خودشون گفتن که علاوه بر مشکلات کشورهای اسلامی، اون فشاری که بر فلسطین داره وارد میشه واقعا غیر قابل تحمله.
Now 3.5 years later, Barack Obama has shown that the oppression of Palestinians is in fact just as tolerable as it was for other American presidents.
و حالا چند سال بعد می‌بینیم که فشاری که روی فلسطینی‌ها هست برای باراک اوباما همونقدر قابل تحمله که برای رئیس جمهورهای قبل از اون بود.
In fact, Barack Obama has increased the amount of U.S. Troops. He increased the amount of U.S. troops in Afghanistan. He broke his pledge to end the imprisonment of prisoners at Guantanamo Bay in Cuba. He broke other pledges as well. He pledged that during his first 4 years in office, he would cut in half the U.S. national public, the federal public debt. Instead, it has grown from $10 to now $16 trillion.
آقای اوباما نه تنها به وعده هایی که داده بودن عمل نکردن، بلکه نیروهای نظامیشون رو در افغانستان، در کوبا افزایش دادن و درصدی رو در صد تلفات ملتشون در کشورهای دیگر رو نه تنها کاهش ندادم بلکه از 10% به excuse me he increased it
from 10 to 16 trillion
از 10 به 16 در 16 تریلیون دلار در مورد اقتصاد صحبت کردن در واقع تلفات اقتصادیشون رو از 10 به 16 تریلیون دلار افزایش دادن.
So now we are coming to a new presidential campaign, but I think we can conclude that no matter who is president, they will still be under a power greater than their own, just as Richard Nixon recognized the power of this Jewish Zionist lobby in the United States. So now I would be glad to take questions that you may have.
و در نهایت به این نتیجه میرسیم که مهم نیست که رئیس جمهور آمریکا چه کسی باشه. همه این رئیس جمهورها در نهایت به همون نتیجه خواهند رسید که ریچارد نیکسون رسید که نمیتونن در برابر قدرت و نفوذ یهودی های صهیونیست مقابله کنند. اگر مایل باشید به سوالات عزیزان پاسخ بدید. Okay, they are asking you about Mr. Zendel. That's why he's in jail. And what have you done to take him out of jail and in his favor?
Ed Zendel is a German-born man who lived for many years in Canada. He was an artist, a graphic artist by occupation.
آقای زندل یک آلمانی بودن که در کانادا متولد شدن.
In the late 1970s, early 1980s, he reprinted a booklet entitled Did 6 Million Really Die? Calling into question the traditional Holocaust story. And he was brought to trial on a charge of, quote, publishing false news. And there were two major trials that took place in Toronto as a result of his publication of that book and these charges.
ایشون آرتیست و گرافیست بودن و یک کتابی منتشر کردن با یک سری کاریکاتورهایی در مورد اینکه هولوکاست رو مورد سوال قرار میداد که آیا واقعا 6 میلیون یهودی کشته شدن و این و بعد از در واقع چاپ این کتاب ماجراهای زیادی در تورنتو پیش اومد.
I was myself a witness for 5 days as an expert witness on World War II history and the Holocaust issue in the second of these two major trials. After these two major trials, he was found guilty, but the case went to the Canadian Supreme Court, and the High Court ultimately decided that the law under which he had been charged was unconstitutional, and he was made free.
برای ایشون دو دادگاه برگزار شد و ایشون آقای وبر در یکی از این دادگاه ها حضور داشتن و در دادگاه دوم ایشون محکوم شناخته شد و بعدها بعد از بررسی مجدد اعلام داشتن که مشکلی نبوده و ایشون آزاد شدن.
But the Zionist groups were determined to try to silence this man even in spite of that. And they then brought new charges against him for having published on an American website an online version of this booklet on a charge that he was promoting hate through the internet.
ولی گروه‌های صهیونیستی مصمم بودند که به هر طریقی آقای زندل رو ساکت بکنن. بعدها اونها راهی که پیدا کردن ایشونو متهم کردن به در واقع انتشار یک نسخه از کتابشون به صورت آنلاین.
And he was brought before hearings of the so-called Human Rights Commission in Toronto, and I testified twice in hearings of this commission on that matter. But the at that time, then Ernst Zundel gave up the fight in Canada and moved to the United States and married a naturalized American citizen.
ایشون به کمیسیون حقوق بشر در تورنتو فراخوانده شدن و یک دادگاه خیلی عجیبی بود که بعد از اون قبل از اینکه تکلیف مشخص بشه ایشون از کانادا خارج شدن و به آمریکا رفتن و با یک شهروند آمریکایی ازدواج کردن.
I remember very vividly, very strongly being in the Human Rights Commission and seeing how his one attorney, he was being defended there against attorneys for major, powerful, wealthy Jewish Zionist organizations, the Canadian Jewish Congress, the Simon Wiesenthal Center of Canada, and B'nai B'rith Canada, which had spent huge amounts of money to try to silence this man.
ایشون به بود در دادگاه بودن و به وضوح میتونستن ببینن که چطور تمام اون دادگاه بر در واقع در تسلط و به نفع صهیونیست‌های بود که به کنگره کانادا و به چند سازمان مهم دیگه کانادا رشوه داده بودن تا اینکه آقای زندن رو به هر نفعی که بود ساکت کنن.
He was then arrested at his home in Tennessee, taken to Canada first, where he was declared a security risk, held in jail there for a time, then sent to Germany, where he was then sentenced to prison in Germany for so-called promoting hate by as supposedly denying the Holocaust.
بعد ایشون در خونه خودشون در آمریکا زندانی شدن و بعد به کانادا انتقال داده شدن. اونجا دادگاهی تشکیل شد و بعد ایشون رو به آلمان محل تولدشون منتقل کردن. و بعد در اونجا ایشون محکوم به زندان شدن به علت در واقع چیزی که میگفتن که نفرتشون از یهود رو نسبت واقعی هولوکاست در یک نسخه آنلاین اینترنتی از کتابشون نشون دادن.
During that time I conducted many interviews, wrote many articles and organized a demonstration outside the first at the Canadian consulate in Toronto on behalf of freedom, for freedom for Ernst Zundel as a political prisoner.
ایشون در اون زمان بسیار مقالات نوشتن در این مورد، مصاحبه‌های فراوانی انجام دادن که آقای زندن باید آزاد بشن.
But of course I wasn't alone. There were many others as well, including of course his American wife Ingrid, who still lives in Tennessee. But eventually Ernst Zundel served the sentence or finished the sentence, was released, and he's now living in West Germany. He's not permitted to go to Canada, he's not permitted to go back to the United States, but he is free to live in Germany as long as, and in freedom, as long as he doesn't say anything else about this particular subject.
البته تنها من نبودم که برایشون فعالیت میکردم. همسر آمریکاییشون هم برای گرفتن حقوقشون فعالیت میکردن که بعدا ایشون هم در خونه خودشون در واقع زندانی بودن، حجر خانگی بودن. بعدا ایشون محکومیت، آقای زندن محکومیت خودشون رو گذروندن و آزاد شدن، ولی اجازه ندارن که وارد ایالات متحده آمریکا یا وارد کانادا بشن. فقط میتونن در آلمان زندگی کنن تا وقتی که هیچ حرفی علیه این موضوع خاص یعنی هولوکاست نزنن.
But the really important thing I came to realize, remember all of this, is the one-sidedness, the hypocrisy, and the injustice of these so-called Holocaust denial laws, which make it illegal to question only this aspect of history. In a number of European countries, it is legal to mock or belittle or smear religious sensibilities, Muslim or Christian, but not to belittle or smear or even question this kind of secular Jewish Holocaust religion.
و نکته جالبی که اینجا هست اینه که بی‌عدالتی آشکاری دیده میشه در مورد دین‌ها، در مورد اینکه شما فقط حق ندارید که در مورد یهودی‌ها و در مورد هولوکاست صحبت کنید، در حالی که در کشور آمریکا و بسیاری کشورهای دیگه شما این آزادی رو دارید که در مورد مسلمان‌ها صحبت کنید، کاریکاتور بکشید، بهشون توهین بکنید.
I've been involved in similar cases involving many others as well. One of the most prominent of those, although I wasn't involved in this, was that of David Irving, who was arrested in Austria for remarks he had made 16 years earlier in Vienna, questioning the Holocaust issue. And he was arrested, tried, and imprisoned in Austria for a time.
What was his name?
David Irving.
آقایشون البته فقط آقای زنده نبودن، یک آقای دیگه به اسم دیوید ارون هم بودن که در اتریش محکوم شدن به زندان به خاطر کاریکاتوری که 16 سال پیش کشیده بودن و موضوعش در واقع سوال کردن بود که آیا هولوکاست واقعیت داره یا نه.
One of the interesting aspects of this case was that when Irving was arrested and put on trial around the world were editorials and newspapers all around the world that were critical of the arrest of David Irving and of the laws under which he had been arrested and charged, even in Austria and Germany.
در مورد آقای اروین نه تنها توی اتریش، در خیلی کشورهای دنیا تظاهراتی شد، در واقع اعتصابهایی شد که چرا قانون اینجوریه.
The only voices supporting the arrest and imprisonment of David Irving and these kinds of laws anymore come from very strictly Zionist organizations like the Simon Wiesenthal Center or the World Jewish Congress. These laws are still in place as a consequence of the defeat of these countries after the end of World War II and of the continuing U.S. and Zionist power in Europe, but they have less and less popular real support. And this is one of the reasons I'm hopeful, and this is a sign that there is a real change in attitude and opinion, I think, around the world, not only about this particular injustice, but many other injustices as well. And I hope this is a good answer to your question.
در مورد این مورد اخیر و در بسیاری موارد دیگه با محکومیت‌های مشابه، تنها صدای حامی از محکومیت اونها صدای کنگره جهانی صهیونیست بود. ولی در سالهای اخیر یک اعتصاب‌های دیگه، یک در واقع مخالفت‌های دیگه هم به گوش می‌رسه که به همین دلیل من امیدوارم و این امید رو احساس می‌کنم که جهان داره تغییر می‌کنه، مردم دارن بیشتر در مورد واقعیت می‌فهمن. Okay, you had a short answer because there are lots of questions. The question is, everyone knows there are these lobbies. Okay, so what do you think can be the solution?
There's no easy solution to dealing with the power of the Jewish Zionist lobby because it is now so much a part of the American system, which is in crisis. My great fear is that this power cannot be broken until there's a real break, a real shock to the entire American system. And that's why I think that the possibility of really changing things within the political system is almost impossible. And that therefore, in America, the only real productive work that can be done right now is educational.
ایشون میگن که به نظر من نمیشه یک راه حل خاصی ارائه داد، چون قدرت و نفوذ و تسلط صهیونیست انقدر عجین شده با کل جامعه و سیاست آمریکا که به نظر نمیرسه بشه اینها رو جدا کرد، مگر اینکه یک شوکی به کل آمریکا وارد بشه. بنابراین من حس میکنم احتمال تغییر به واسطه یک همچین شوکی، احتمال یک همچین شوکی حتی ناممکنه، مگر اینکه ما مردم رو در واقع تحصیلات، در واقع دادن دانش به مردم که واقعیت رو به دوش مردم برسونه.
That's my short answer to your question.
وقتی ما برگشتیم در باره ایران،
They are asking when you will be back to US, okay, what will you tell to those 70% people who believe Iranian people love war? What will you tell them?
My ability. I'm just the head of a very small organization. We can't compete with Warner Brothers or 20th Century Fox or major studios or NBC or CNN or Fox News. We aim our work not at the 70%. We can't hope to do that. We aim only at a minority. In every society, the percentage of people who have the intelligence and have the heart to think about and care about these kinds of issues is always only a tiny minority. The vast majority of people in every society are concerned first and foremost with going through their daily lives, their work, their family, their friends, and themselves. And we know that we can't really reach those people. We try instead to reach the small minority of people who can and must be leaders in the future if we're to have a future.
من رئیس یک در واقع سازمان خیلی کوچیکی هستم. بنابراین کار زیادی از دست من بر نمیاد. ولی کاری که من خواهم کرد، کاری که ما میکنیم، ما هدف رو اون 70% قرار نمیدیم. ما نمیتونیم حریف CNN و بقیه شرکت‌های خبری و بقیه در واقع غول‌های خبری آمریکا بشیم. ولی ما هدفمون رو اون اقلیت مردمی که میتونن ذهنشون رو و قلبشون رو به کار بگیرن و فکر کنن و واقعیت رو ببینن، ما اونها رو هدف قرار میدیم و امیدواریم که اونها هستن که در واقع پتانسیل رهبریت آینده رو دارن و امیدواریم که اونها بتونن تغییر بدن. What is the percentage? Okay, people accept Israeli people, okay, Zionists in America. I mean, American people, not the government. What percent of them, they just, that's reasonable for them, the presence of Israel and supporting them?
Yeah. The American people tend to accept whatever is happening as long as it doesn't hurt them personally. That's the unfortunate situation in America. So that all sorts of injustice and bad things can be done, but the vast majority of the American people don't feel strongly motivated to do much about it unless it affects them personally. In my lifetime, the American people have come to accept things that 40 or 50 years ago, people would have thought, everybody would have thought would have been impossible to accept.
در واقع مسئله تأسف‌بار این هست که مردم آمریکا در مورد هیچ موضوعی توجه و در واقع علاقه نشون نمیدن تا وقتی که به ضرر شخص خودشون نباشه. ولی این رو همیشه گفت که الان جهان و آمریکا داره تغییر میکنه. الان مردم به چیزهایی معتقدن و اعتقاد دارن که 40 یا 50 سال پیش هیچ وقت فکر نمیکردن بهشون معتقد باشن. Do you think this threatening for war, is it serious or is it just the same?
The one reason I think it's serious is because it's dangerous for any country to make threats and then not do anything. If a country makes threats and says, we will attack you, in this case, we will attack you unless you stop your nuclear energy program, and then doesn't do it, people will not take that country seriously in the future. Israel has been making these threats for years, and perhaps they're empty. But it's not wise for an intelligent, a good government to make threats and not do anything either. I don't know what's going to happen. And there are some very wise people who give good reasons why Israel will not attack, because it would be so stupid. But there are others who say that Netanyahu is so strange and weird that he will do it. So I don't know really the answer to the question of whether there will be an attack or not.
میگم دلیل این که من در سخنانم هم گفتم که به نظر من باید جدی گرفته بشه اینه که برای یک کشور خوب نیست که که همواره یک تهدیدی رو اعلام بکنه و بعد به اون عمل نکنه. در واقع برای وجهه اون کشور جالب نخواهد بود اگر حتی دست خالی هست اسرائیل، ولی سالهاست که داره تهدید میکنه که من جنگ خواهم کرد، من حمله خواهم کرد اگر شما سلاح هسته‌ای رو، در واقع تولید سلاح هسته‌ایتون رو متوقف نکنید. بنابراین سالهاست که داره تهدید میکنه و یک در واقع حرکت عاقلانه نیست که یک دولت یک کاری رو که نخواهد کرد بارها تکرار بکنه. بنابراین من درست نمیتونم بگم که جدی هست یا نه. Actually, they say that any war with Iran means losing 60% of the oil supply of the Middle East.
Yes.
Do you think American government is that stupid to ignore this reality?
The American government knows that very well, of course. They know that this would be catastrophic. And even in Israel, there are many people, even high-level people, that say such a war would be stupid, would be absurd. And that's absolutely true. But Netanyahu may do that. Those are very good reasons why there will not be war. But Israel, as you everyone knows, is making these threats. So maybe that's a good reason why there won't be a war.
دولت آمریکا دقیقاً میدونه این مسئله رو که یک بحران خواهد بود اگر جنگی پیش بیاد. مردم اسرائیل هم دقیقاً این رو میدونن. ولی اسرائیل داره تهدید میکنه. شاید اینکه اینها میدونن یک دلیل آشکاری است که هیچ وقت جنگ نخواهد شد. ولی با این وجود نمیشه گفت اسرائیل داره همچنان تهدید میکنه. In 1967, okay, an Israeli Israel attacked an American ship called USS something, Liberty. Yeah, USS Liberty. How many percent of the people of America know that Israel has done something like this?
Yes. Very, very few people know about it. I have met a number of people who were survivors of the attack, including James Ennis, the commander. I met one of the survivors spoke at one of our meetings. I've read many books about the subject. Of course, people who want to can find out about that, but that's typical. People who want to know can find out this kind of information. But the U.S. government has done everything to keep, and an Israeli government, to keep this away from public knowledge, and so the vast majority of people know nothing about it, of course.
من با چند نفر از کسانی که در اون حادثه زنده بودن هم ملاقات داشتم، در مورد حادثه، در مورد حمله اسرائیل شنیدم، ولی درصد خیلی کمی از مردم در مورد این میدونن، چون دولت آمریکا این رو به گوش هیچ کس نرسونده. ولی هر کس که بخواد، در واقع موضوع اینه که اگر کسی بخواد میتونه در موردش بدونه، ولی خب مردم آمریکا تلاشی در جهت فهمیدن حقیقت نداشتن. America is involved in many crises right now. Okay. Do you think it is because of Zionists? Have they supported these crises?
Well, yes. Well, I would say this.
for years, the Jewish Zionist power in the United States has promoted policies which have led to this crisis. They're perhaps not responsible in a direct way, but there is a very large measure of responsibility in an indirect way. And I mean that because those who have the most power in a healthy in a society have the most responsibility. And the power of the Jewish minority in America, stronger, more powerful than that of any other single ethnic religious group, means it should have more responsibility for what is happening. But they are trying to have maximum power with minimal responsibility. And that's part of the tragedy of the American system today.
اول گفتن بله ولی نمیدونم شاید نشه گفت که مستقیم در واقع حمایت کنندگان یا علت اصلی این بحران ها اسرائیلی ها هستند ولی سیاست های آمریکایی اسرائیلی که در طول سالها شکل گرفته میتونه از علل اساسی این باشه انقدر که نفوذ و قدرت فرامون به اسرائیلی ها به صهیونیست ها داده شده و الان روش کار صهیونیست‌ها اینجوری هست که قدرت فراوان بیشترین قدرت و کمترین مسئولیت پذیری. این یک تراژدیه. میگم ساعت چی شه میخوام؟ چند تا سوال هست؟ Only three, four. You have to go somewhere. Only three, four more questions. It happens here. Three, four more questions.
He said six. It's okay for me.
که در واقع دستن در کارم گفتن که زمان کنفرانس به ساعت 6 من مشکلی ندارم ولی There is no problem. They are honored to be here. How can American people accept it? How can they digest it that with their tax money, with the money that they are giving as tax, the Palestinians are being killed while they have economical crisis in their own country?
Very important to understand is that although Americans are anxious and they're concerned and they're fearful, they don't understand how this has all happened. We had a few years ago something called the Tea Party movement, which was a kind of protest of people who consider themselves conservative. And then last year we had something called the Occupy Wall Street, generally by people who consider themselves liberal. They're very angry, they're upset, but they don't know who to blame for the problem. They don't know what the solution is. They're confused. Because in America, unlike other countries, we've had the same flag, the same, at least in name, same constitution, same money, all in place for more than 200 years. Americans cannot conceive of anything really radically different. It's very hard for Americans to know if we have such a wonderful system which has brought such prosperity in the past, how has it failed? Most Americans don't know and understand why this has happened. And I have done what I can to try to explain what the tragedy of America is. But for the vast majority of people in the United States, this is very confusing, so they tolerate a great deal while they're still very unhappy and even angry.
مردم آمریکا بسیار در واقع مضطرب و بسیار پریشون هستن ولی نمیتونن در واقع حل فصل کنن که این مشکل از کجا میخوره. چند سال پیش یک جنبشی به نام تی پارتی تشکیل شد که مردم سعی کردن اونجا بفهمن که قضیه چیه. الان جنبش تسخیر وال استریت هست ولی مسئله اینه که آمریکا برخلاف خیلی کشورهای دیگه در طی 100 سال گذشته یک پرچم داشته، یک ساختار داشته. بنابراین مردم نمیتونن باور کنن که چطور شده که الان داره رو به سقوط میره. مشکل اصلی کجاست؟ مسئله کجاست؟ مردم عادی، عموم مردم قدرت حل و فصل رو ندارن. خیلی براشون گیج کننده است.
Yeah. When the Occupy Wall Street movement began, I think in March of 2011, I was asked even by Radio in Iran, about this. And I predicted what would happen. There would be a kind of movement and so forth, and it would make headlines, and then it would disappear. It's basically disappeared. Because the Occupy Wall Street movement is incoherent. It's confused. They are angry at Wall Street, but they didn't occupy Wall Street. They occupied public parks. And they direct their anger not at Wall Street, which is doing legally whatever it can to make money. They direct their anger at that. Even though they're doing something legally just to make money, they should direct their anger at the politicians who've allowed this injustice, who've allowed all this to take place. But they don't. The people of Occupy Wall Street movement voted overwhelmingly for Barack Obama. But they should direct their anger at the politicians who've permitted all of this to take place, because that's where power is. But the Occupy Wall Street movement has no leadership, it has no real goals, and that's why it's disappeared with a great deal of frustration.
در ماه مارس سال 2011 که جنبش وال استریت در واقع تصویر وال استریت شروع شد، من یک مصاحبه با رادیو ایران هم داشتم. من در واقع این پیشبینی رو کردم که این جنبش به مرور و دیر یا زود در واقع فروکش خواهد کرد، هیچ نتیجه خاصی نخواهد داشت، چون افرادی که این جنبش وال استریت رو دارن در واقع راه اندازی کردن، اینها عصبانیت و خشم خودشون رو متوجه بانک ها، متوجه سرمایه‌داران، کسایی کردن که در وال استریت شاید دارن قانونی کار میکنن، در حالی که طرف اونها باید سیاستمدارهایی باشن که این سیاست ها رو اینطور بنا گذاشتن، این که این سیاست های سیستم سرمایه گذاری رو در واقع اینجوری بنا نهادن. جنبش وال استریت هیچ رهبری خاصی نداره، هیچ هدف خاصی نداره. مردم حتی وال استریت رو اشغال نکردن، مردم پارک های عمومی رو اشغال کردن. بنابراین دیر یا زود این جنبش فرو خواهد رفت. حمایت دینی کیا؟ من این لغت رو متاسفانه درست evangelist. Okay. What do you think about the religious support of these evangelists from
Yeah, this is a question about Christian Zionists, the evangelical fundamentalist Christians that support Israel. They do so because this is a form of their identity. They're very influenced by propaganda, by motion pictures. They remember pictures like the Ten Commandments with Charlton Heston. They have a very romanticized view of Israel. But this propaganda is powerful again in America because people don't have a secure or really well-formed idea themselves of their own interests and their own identity. The Christian Zionist movement is the fundamentalist Christian public in America on all other issues has lost ground over the last 20, 30, 40, 50 years. The only issue that they seem to be successful in is their support for Israel, but that's not because of them, it's because they've aligned themselves, supported this Israel lobby, this Zionist lobby. But the support is widespread but very thin. It's really not based on anything very serious. And in fact, it's kind of crazy because Christian Zionists believe that the founding of the State of Israel is the step just before an Armageddon when the whole world will end. In other words, you don't have to really worry about all these problems because this Armageddon will come and all the good Christians that they believe will be saved, and everybody else, including Israel and the Jews, will all die and go to hell.
صهیونیسم مسیحی در واقع اونها ساپورتشون از اسرائیلی ها در یک حد بسیار کمی بوده، ساپورتی که اونها داشتن، و اونها درست میدونن که اگر که قراره یک در واقع اتفاقی بیفته قبل از اون جنگ یک جنگ بزرگ خواهد بود و بعد از اون همه چیز از بین خواهد رفت و این مسیحا هستن که به بهش خواهد رفت و بقیه همه به جهنم خواهد رفت.
It's important to remember that this strange phenomenon of Christian Zionism exists only in the United States. It's something unique to the United States because of the uniqueness of American history. Christians overwhelmingly around the world reject this idea. They are supportive of rights for Palestinians and oppose Israeli policies against the Palestinians. And this Christian Zionism is an expression of a very odd kind of identity and a very odd expression of a certain group only within really the United States of America because of its unique special history.
این صهیونیسم مسیحی یک در واقع مسئله هست موضوعی است که فقط در آمریکا مطرحه در تمام مسیحی‌ها در تمام کشورهای دنیا همه طرفدار فلسطین هستن همه مخالف اسرائیل هستن ولی این هم باز برمیگرده به در واقع رفتارهای متفاوت مردم آمریکا که یک همچین چیزی به نام صهیونیسم مسیحی در آمریکا شکل گرفته. According to Talmud, okay, extremist Jewish people, they believe that people other than Jewish people, they all are animals and they must be yours. آخر سوال چی بود به وقتی؟ آخر سوال، جمعه Do you think Zionism is just invented out of this idea?
This is an important question. Is the problem only Zionism, or is there a Jewish problem? Ever since the very beginning of time, there has always been tension between Jews and non-Jews. In ancient Egypt, in ancient Rome, in European countries for centuries, there has been this problem, this Jewish question. And it's because there is something unique about the Jewish religion. As reflected in the Talmud, a tribal sense. The Jewish religion is the only remaining tribal religion in the world. Islam and Christianity are universal religions. They are open to all people, and they are a relationship between man and God. The Jewish religion is only for the Hebrew people, the Jewish people, and it is a covenant or a contract or a relationship between God and one people. It's different than all other religions. And it is a tribal group fortified by a religion, and this is a problem.
در واقع مسئله اینجاست که آیا یهودیت یهودیت و صهیونیسم اینها یکی هستن یا نه. از خیلی وقت پیش از بسیار سال پیش همیشه بین یهودی‌ها و طرفداران در واقع پیروان سایر مذهب‌ها مشکل وجود داشته. سایر مذهب‌ها همه دین‌های جهانی هستند. تنها دین یهودی هست که یک دین قبیله‌ای است که برای یک افراد خاص در واقع فرستاده شده.
This is not just in the Talmud, it's in the Jewish scriptures, the Tanakh, the Old Testament as well. And this Jewish question existed here in Iran also many, many years ago. One book of the Jewish Testament, the Tanakh, the Old Testament, is the book of Esther. The book of Esther is considered by Jews a holy book, but there is no mention of God in this book. It's only a story about the triumph of the Jewish people against their enemies in Persia. And as I understand, Esther is buried in Persia to this day. Perhaps Islam is the answer to this question, because in Islamic countries,
there has not been the same kind of tension as there has been in other countries. But at least in America and Europe, there has been not just a Zionist issue and a problem, there has been a Jewish question.
این موضوعی که یهودی ها در مورد صحبت میکنن در کتاب اونها در تورات به ادعای خودشون هست. در یک کتابی به نام کتاب ایستر همین مطرح شده که کتاب مقدسی هست برای اونها. شاید جواب این سوال در اسلام هست. شاید این مشکل از کشورهای اسلامی در واقع بهش پاسخ داده شده، ولی در آمریکا و اروپا حداقل این مشکل یهودی و صهیونیسم همچنان وجود داره. The polls show that murder, abortion, and theft, it is going so up in America, okay? So how do you think how much media has been effective in this?
And how much
media
has been, what in
has been just causing this, that murder, all these problems in the society, okay? How much media caused this? And how much Zionism has had effect on this?
Yes. It's an indirect thing, because when human beings try to live just as individuals, they are not living according to their real nature. Human beings are both individuals and social beings, and they have also social responsibilities. And the doctrine pushed by the mass media, Jewish control, is this model of diversity as our strength, individualism, individual concern, selfishness. A society with those kinds of values is one in which there will be more unhappiness, strife, conflict, and so forth. All these social problems are manifestations of a consumerist, materialistic, liberalistic, individual self-centeredness in society, and the media, largely Jewish control, has been promoting, pushing these values in American society with very dangerous consequences. And that's, to that extent, yes, that's a very, very serious problem.
موضوع برمیگرده به این که مردم آمریکا همینطور که قبلا هم گفتیم در واقع به صورت شخص واحد هستن. هر کس دنیای در واقع اطراف خودش رو داره، و در حالی که انسان ها باید اجتماعی باشن، ما باید در قبال اجتماع هم مسئولیت پذیر باشیم، ولی میتونیم بگیم که همون باور صهیونیست ها که میگفتن تنوع قدرت ماست، این رو از طریق مطبوعات و صدا و سیما هم به مردم قبولوندن که هر قدر که شما شخصی تر باشید، دایره شخصی خودتون رو داشته باشید، شرایطتون بهتر خواهد بود. و به این ترتیب مسلماً هر قدر که انسان ها بیشتر فقط به فکر خودشون باشن، آمار قتل و بقیه مشکلات جامعه بالا خواهد.
Yes. Thank you very much for having me speak here today. When I first came, I was a little embarrassed because I wanted to have some better clothes, a longer shirt and a jacket, because I wasn't prepared. I thought we were going back to the hotel first. But it's been so hot that I'm glad I have this shirt. And I'm very, very admiring of those people who have even heavier clothing who have endured all of this. So I appreciate very much you staying for my talk today.
ایشون میگن که قبل اینکه بیام من یه مقدار نگران بودم، چون دقیقاً آماده نبودم برای اومدن به اینجا. قرار بود که برگردم به هتل و لباسامو عوض کنم، لباس رسمی‌تری بپوشم، کتم رو بپوشم، ولی الان خوشحالم که نرفتم، چون انقدر گرمه اینجا که حتی با این لباس آستین کوتاه هم گرممه. و متشکرم از همه شما که توی این گرما هم نشستین و به حرفای من گوش دادین.
در دنیا اونطور که بنده نگاه کردم و بررسی کردم قرآن قرآن مردمیه نه انسان و همین میگه که ببینید قرآن به یک دیگه و سرگیز و تبابوس آده وقتی از این دیگه را صحبت میکنه که برای این داری اما وقتی در روزی سرگیز کنه که کشته میکنه صحبت میکنه اون در هر وقتی هم صحبت میکنه و قادر به الله
Yeah.